Recording in progress. Selamat siang. Baik, selamat siang kepada Bapak Ibu. Saya ucapkan selamat datang dan terima kasih kepada Bapak Ibu yang sudah hadir dalam acara kami di Engineer's Talk SGU Optimizing Production Scheduling in Manufaktur 24 November 2021. Izinkan saya memperkenalkan diri, saya Kiki selaku MC dengan narasumber kita adalah Ibu Rosalind Dwi Oktaviana. Beliau MMA student dan beliau bekerja di PT Bahler Indonesia. Saya senang sekali dapat bertemu dan menyapa Bapak Ibu dalam series Engineer's Talk kali ini. Sebagai informasi, webinar ini juga kami siarkan secara langsung melalui live streaming YouTube. Sebelum acara dimulai, alangkah baiknya kita berdoa terlebih dahulu menurut kepercayaan dan agama masing-masing. Berdoa dimulai. Berdoa selesai. Sesi selanjutnya akan ada sambutan dari Bapak Dena Hendriana, BSc SM SCD, selaku Kepala Program Studi MMA. Yang terhormat kepada Bapak Dena, waktu dan tempat kami persilahkan.
Ya, terima kasih Mbak Kiki untuk waktunya. Salam kenal teman-teman semua yang hadir dalam acara ini. Acara ini, Engineer's Talk ini, kita selenggarakan dari Master of Mechanical Engineering sebagai bagian dari tugas kita ya dari Prodi untuk memberikan pengabdian pada masyarakat, share terhadap apa yang pengetahuan bersama-sama lah gitu. Nah, kebetulan hari ini spesial karena kita akan share dari aktivitas pembelajaran kita di SGU, dari aktivitas tesis, proses pembuatan tesis, di mana di tengah-tengah atau dilakukan suatu colloquium atau progress report yang dilakukan oleh student kepada advisor-nya. Kebetulan pada posisi ini advisor-nya adalah Dr. Gembong Baskoro yang akan memandu sebagai moderator dan juga sebagai penanya utama ya dalam prosesnya, yang tentunya kemudian akan di ekstra waktunya akan dibagikan untuk menjawab pertanyaan dari hadirin semua. Jadi ini ada suatu proses pembelajaran yang kami ingin memperkenalkan kepada teman-teman semua bagaimana proses pembuatan tesis dan pembelajarannya yang berlaku di Swiss German University, tepatnya di Prodi Master of Mechanical Engineering ya. Kebetulan sekarang kita memiliki dua konsentrasi ya, yaitu yang pertama adalah mekatronik dan yang kedua adalah engineering management ya. Kebetulan pembicara hari ini adalah datang dari fokus yang kedua yaitu engineering management ya. Mungkin tanpa memperbanyak waktu, saya kembalikan kepada Mbak Kiki. Terima kasih.
Baik, terima kasih Pak Dena atas sambutannya. Sebelum acara dimulai, kami perkenalkan untuk moderator hari ini adalah Bapak Insinyur Gembong Baskoro, MSc, dengan jabatan saat ini selaku Senior Lecturer Program Studi MMA Program. Baik, langsung saja kita mulai. Kami persilakan kepada Bapak Gembong untuk memulai SGU Engineer's Talk hari ini. Silakan Pak Gembong, waktu dan tempat dipersilakan.
Ya, terima kasih. Selamat sore semua. Jadi hari ini kita dijadwalkan untuk melaksanakan paparan dari mahasiswa magister ya, dalam waktu yang telah disediakan. Nah, paparan ini berjudul Optimizing Production Scheduling in Manufacturing ya. Saya lihat di sini ada mahasiswa ya, tentunya banyak nih mahasiswa saya sendiri ya, dan juga ada beberapa mungkin peserta dari luar. Untuk itu saya persilakan ya Rosalin ya untuk memaparkan perkembangan dari risetnya. Silakan.
Thank you, Pak Gemong. I will start to share about my thesis progress. Can you all see my screen?
Yes.
So good afternoon, everybody. A little bit introduction about myself. My name is Rosalin, and I am a student under Swiss German University, Master of Mechanical Engineering, Engineering Management Concentration. I'm also an automation engineer at Bueller Indonesia, and today I would like to share some information about my thesis project. It is about optimizing production scheduling in Indonesian customized spare part and machine manufacturer using hybrid tabu search and genetic algorithm method. So my thesis project actually is not yet finished. So today I would like to focus more about to the problem identification and also the method that I use. If you have any question, you can ask me later and I will try to answer my best. Okay, I will start. So in this presentation, there will be several sections. The first one is introduction, and then literature review, research method, data collection and analysis, result and discussion, and also the summary. So a little bit introduction about the background. Why I choose this topic is because we all know that nowadays, customer satisfaction is one of the key factors of a company performance. And this statement has been backed up by numerous studies. And it is also said in the journal paper by Metzler in 2004 that state that there's a positive relationship between customer satisfaction and company profitability. And then one of the strategies to be implemented is to always maintain the required performance or the ability of a manufacturer to meet the scheduled delivery time. This statement is supported by a research conducted by Ketter and Ketter in 2009, which state that delivery performance can positively influence the degree of customer satisfaction. However, it is still unfortunate that some manufacturers are still having difficulties in maintaining their delivery performance. And this is also the case for a company called PT Fancy. This company is works in manufacturing industry. It is specialized in mass customization and personalization. Its main activities is spare part and machine manufacturing and assembling using several of these machines, such as lathe machine, CNC, milling, scrap, grinding, chrome, and also labor work. A little bit overview about the company system production part. Actually, there are two main production type that in a manufacturing company. The first one is job shop and the second one is flow shop. So the difference is in job shop, the flow for manufacturing a product is different from the flow for manufacturing the other product. So here, for example, job one is to manufacture a product. So for job one, first it goes to the process number one, and then to process number three, and then finish. But for job number two, this is first go to process number two, and then to process number one, and then to number three, and then finish. So the flow is different for each job or for each product. And then in flow shop, the route is the same for all products. So here we can see for job one, two, three, it goes to the process one, and then to the process two, and then to the process three, and then finish. So if we summarize, the difference is in job shop, the processing route is different based on the product, but in pro shop, the processing route is the same for our product. And then in job shop, the product priority is high, whereas in pro shop, it is low. And then in job shop, the product quantity is low to medium, and in pro shop, the product quantity is large. Based on this comparison, we can conclude that the PTKMC falls in the job shop category. This is because they are operating in mass customization and personalization. Usually, the pro shop is for mass production only. And then this is the company problem. The company problem. So when they receive order from customer, now they adjust the work schedule manually without any supporting software or tools. And therefore, sometimes they miss something like project overlapping, project deadline, and also they forgot that they have limited resources. And this makes the difficulties in meeting the production lead time target during the execution. And then it leads to the late delivery and then leads to the verbal complaint from the customer. So to summarize, the research problem here is the company has difficulties in maintaining their delivery performance. Sometimes late delivery is inevitable, which leads to verbal complaints from the customer. And the objective in this research is to present a method that can help the company to meet the production lead time target and improve delivery performance. The significance of study of this thesis is first to evaluate the previous methods that has been successfully implemented to improve a company's delivery performance. And the second one is to evaluate the purpose method, which is using hybrid tab search and genetic algorithm method and its effect to production lead time. This is the scope and limitation when developing the algorithm to solve the late delivery issue. First is on the machine, no overlap is allowed in start and end times for any job task. So job here represents a PO or a purchase order, and task here represent the process to manufacture this product. So like the process number 1, 2, and 3. And then the task within the same job cannot be started unless all tasks within the same job with a sequence number less than the current task are complete. This means that when manufacturing a product, there is a certain sequence rule to be followed. So the product must go to machine number 1, and then to number 2, number 3, and number 4, and so on. So this sequence, we have to follow the sequence when developing the schedule. And then each task can only be run on certain machines. And then for this PCS, the maintenance machine breakdown and end time target is ignored. And then the objective is to schedule the tasks from all jobs on the machine such that the completion time or max span is minimized. And then these are the research questions. The first one is, what is the cause of the difficulties in meeting the production lead time target? And the second one is, how to reach the production lead time target and improve the delivery performance. This is the expected result. We hope that by implementing the hybrid table search and generic algorithm method for production scheduling, it has the positive influence on the delivery performance. And these are some literature review from several journal papers that I have compiled. So here we can see that since 2006, even before that, actually, the genetic algorithm and tabu search has been very popular for optimizing the production scheduling. This algorithm can be implemented in pro shop and also in job shop problem, but maybe just a little bit modification in the program itself. And then we see here that many people are actually studying the combination of genetic algorithm and tabu search together, because If we see at result, by combining Tom Research and general algorithm, it has improved the algorithm to produce an even better schedule. And therefore, that's why I propose to use also the genetic algorithm and table search method. Okay, and then this is the research method to develop this disease. I follow the make framework. So the first one is define. In define process, I first identify the problem, which is the company has difficulties in maintaining their delivery performance. And then a literature review, it is about the previous research, and then the related theories, and also from the preliminary company data. And then the research design, this is by taking into consideration the type of the production type of the company, mass customization and personalization, and then the unavailability of production planning tool, and also to combine the advantage of genetic algorithm and tab search. And then in the measure phase, I collect the data. It is from the production process sequence for each PO, and also the data from the company project historical data. And then in analyze phase, first we find the root cause of the problem, and then we implement this hybrid tab search and genetic algorithm. And then next to the improve phase, we compare the production lead time after implementing the proposed method with the previous condition. And then in control, we establish the work procedures for future company use. So even after this process has ended, the company still can use the software that I have developed. And the last one is conclusion and recommendation. And then these are several data analysis that has been done. The first data is the offset target to actual finish date from 2020 to 2021. So from data here, we can see that 40% of the project delivered by this company, and 55% of project delivered on time, and only 5% of project delivered ahead of time. The percentage here is causing trouble because 40% of the project is delivered late. And then after further analysis, we analyze the machine learning hour from 2020 until 2021. Here we can see that the most used machine is machine M2, AC4, and BCNT1. And then this is the machine usage pattern for late PO. So when they are having a late delivery issue, these are the machines that is being used in the production line. You can see here that about 25% of PO that has late delivery uses machine M2, and about 24% of PO that has late delivery uses machine BCNT1 in the production line. This data match with the data of most used machine, which is M2 and BCNT1. And then we suspect that maybe there is an inefficiency in scheduling the job tasks for machine M2 and BCNC1. Okay, so this is a brief summary of what I do for my thesis project. So I developed the production planning tool to act during job planning, which is to schedule the resources. And then this can help the company to meet the production lead time target and improve their delivery performance. And then this application software is developed using Python. And the input variable will be the number of job or PO, and then the number of tasks or the process sequence that must be followed. And then the process sequence per job and or per PO, and then the required processing time per job and per machine. And then the output would be the Excel file schedule and also Gantt chart schedule. And this is the input data for the software. So here we can see that there are job, task, sequence, usable machine, and time. The job here represents the PO. So, So job number zero is PO, PO zero. And then the task is the process sequence that must be followed. And here the sequence is 0, 1, 2, 3. It is also the sequence that the sequence for the task. And then the usable machine is the machine that can be used for each task. And then the time is the processing time for each machine in each task. And then this is the output. So the first one is the Gantt chart in the left side. This is the schedule, the production scheduling from the software. Then the right side here is the Excel file if the employee wants to see the detailed data. Okay, so this is the summary of my thesis. So my thesis is about the resource constraint job shop scheduling problem, and the constraint is the machine availability. The problem here is the duration of a project might be increased if the resources are not adequate to meet demands or like delivery issue. And the solution is by knowing the schedule prediction ahead of time, it will leave time for consideration of reasonable alternatives. For example, the first one is cost time trade-off, scheduling overtime work. And then the second one is change in priorities, which PO must be executed first. And then the last one is maybe reschedule alternatives. So maybe before dealing with the potential customer, if we know beforehand what is the schedule prediction like, we can adjust the delivery, estimated delivery time for this potential customer. Okay, I think that's all for me. Thank you.
Thank you, Rosaline. Yeah, great presentation, yeah, from you. And now we are moving to the question and answer session. For you guys who want to ask the question, please raise your hand or you can write it down in the chat room. Yeah. Anyway, I have a list of questions already here, Rosa. Let me read one by one. Yeah. First question, can this method apply to MSME? I don't know what the question means, MSME. Yeah. Perhaps SME, small medium enterprise, yeah? I don't know. But I guess this question means, can this method apply to small medium enterprise?
Yes, this method can be applied if they are like in a manufacturing industry sector, because there is no job task limitation, no machine limitation here in the algorithm. So yeah, if they want to use it, they can.
Okay.
Maybe later in the there might be some adjustment in the program to suit their needs, but theoretically, yes.
Okay, the second question. Do you apply such kind of meta heuristic method in your work?
Meta heuristic, yes. The genetic algorithm and tabu search is a part of meta heuristic method for schedule optimization.
Okay, so the question is yes, the answer. The next question. How about the obstacle in manufacturing industry?
For me, I think some obstacle in manufacturing industry is first the limited resources. We can see here. That's why I developed an optimization scheduling program in order to have a better schedule when you have a limited resources. I think that's one obstacle, limited resources. And the second one is unforeseen circumstances like machine breakdown, raw material delay, And yeah, something like that.
Okay, thank you, Rosa. Here we have a question in the chat room. Yeah, what's the difference between genetic algorithm and conventional optimization algorithm?
So genetic algorithm is a meta heuristic approach, and as far as I know, conventional optimization is heuristic approach, and meta heuristic is a better version of the heuristic approach because it can generate better results. And then in meta heuristic, there are many kinds of algorithm that can be used, not only genetic algorithm, but like double search genetic algorithm, simulated annealing, DBO, and many more. So the difference is in the also in the concept. In the concept itself, it's different for each algorithm.
Okay, the further question. Can we apply this method in machine learning? I don't know what he mean by machine learning.
Yeah, can you elaborate that? What you mean apply this in machine learning?
Ahmad Patoni.
Yeah, Pak.
So, what do you mean?
Because you know, good afternoon, Bu. Mas Salim, Bung. So, because currently the machine learning is trained. So, because inside the machine learning, for some method, my question is, can we apply or this method for the genetic algorithm as the part of in machine learning? It's just question. Because I've seen this for in this method, we will optimize. Yeah? From the our problem, so I think I don't know. It's just question. Maybe because the objective of the machine learning also will solve the problem. That's my question.
I think genetic algorithm is a framework for you to use to solve any problem. So I think I think this algorithm can be used for in machine learning, but I think also this genetic algorithm is a part of machine learning because it is some kind of optimization problem.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks, Rosalind. Next question. How to decrease level stock meanwhile achieve target of delivery? I don't know. How to decrease level stock meanwhile achieve target of delivery?
Maybe in a decrease inventory stock.
Yeah, I guess so.
For this, I think for inventory stock, I think this needs like market analysis, trend analysis, like following the trend and then analyze the market demand, and then after that we can predict which material to stock and which material not to stock. I think it has something to do with the market trend analysis.
Okay, thank you. You guys can, yeah, also write it down your question in chat room. Yeah, of course. Yeah, while I'm reading the question from the way up. Another question: what are the key components to optimize the production scheduling?
I think the most crucial is the scheduling. In order to have a better production scheduling, you need a good planning with your limited resources, by considering the unforeseen circumstances like the machine breakdown or raw material delay. So I think it The planning stage is the most crucial and important part.
What about the data, the, you know, the correctness of the data or something like that?
What do you mean by the correctness of the data?
Yeah, because I don't know, in the production, yeah, whether your data is real life data or data collected by person, right? If it is real life data, then it is, of course, it's always correct, right? But if the data is collected by person, and we are unsure until we prove that the data is, you know, already being screened out, yeah.
But if the data comes from the company itself, can it be manipulated?
Not manipulated, but sometimes people, you know, if they are in a, misalnya ya, shift 3 itu kan ngantuk ya. Ya perhaps dia ya buru-buru mau pulang, mau tidur dan sebagainya. Nah, itu bisa saja dia mengisi data is not apa ya, this is not precise. I don't know, you experience already in the you know, in the shop floor, whether it is affect you the scheduling or not.
You mean like the data for the pieces, the product, the manufactured pieces that is not accurate?
Yes, the accuracy of the data, I mean.
That's the risk if we still use the data from the human, right? There's always the human error factor. And yeah, that's why I think the automation is nowadays become more popular to minimize this kind of risk, the human error risk.
Okay. Next question. What tools or method to optimize production scheduling in manufacturer?
Actually, there are many ways, many approaches that you can use. Maybe you can use the PSM. You can use meta heuristic approach. You can use heuristic approach. I think it depends again on the company type and how and what is the problem in the company and what can be done to the company, because what is suitable for the company.
Okay, thank you very much. Now, this is another question, but in bahasa Indonesia ya, bahwa sekarang sudah mulai kembali aktivitas seperti sebelum ada pandemi ini, sehingga pesanan-pesanan yang tadinya menurun dan sekarang bahkan melonjak pesat. Bagaimana menyikapi orderan yang menumpuk? Mulai dari persiapan bahan baku hingga pengiriman. So you mean we got, you know, after the pandemic, yeah, nowadays, yeah, the order is getting, you know, unbelievable. Then how you manage this? Bagaimana menyikapi ordernya mulai menumpuk, yeah, because you have to prepare the, you know, the raw material and until you process and then you deliver.
I think the first step is again the market analysis, because if the order, I mean orderan yang tiba-tiba banyak itu nggak datang dalam satu malam kan, tapi pasti datangnya pelan-pelan. So market analysis is important when the company has already see that the market demand is increasing, then they have to start stock up their inventory. And then after that, they can use something like this scheduling tool, because it can produce a schedule in like 30 seconds or something. And then when, for example, they receive an order from the customer, they can like make prediction about what is the required time to finish it, and they can input to the software, and then they can see the prediction, the end time prediction based on the software. And then before they are dealing with the customer, they can maybe do some revision to the schedule of delivery time if needed to avoid like delivery issue. Or if for the ongoing PO that will be delivered late, if they know beforehand, then they can inform the customer nggak tiba-tiba, tapi bisa dari jauh-jauh hari.
Okay. Now this is a little bit different with production, but the point is similar. How to increase production, yeah, with maintenance schedule. So you want to increase the production, but with the how you work out in the maintenance schedule.
For maintenance, first, I would say that we have follow the machine manufacturer's recommendation for maintenance. If the maintenance is scheduled for example after 10,000 running hour, then we have to follow it. If not, then the machine can have a breakdown possibility, which we don't want. And at first it might be we think that maintenance is taking too much time that we can allocate for production, right? But after the machine breakdown, the repair will take more time than the maintenance time itself, which is just the same or even worse. And then the maintenance can be done two ways: preventive and predictive. So preventive maintenance is to avoid machine breakdown, and then predictive maintenance is an even better maintenance approach. Then we also prevent machine prevent any trouble in the machine and machine breakdown.
Okay, the last question. Yeah. In your opinion, yeah. How about the operation within 24 hours of machine operation? What is your opinion if we want to operate in 24 hours?
I think it depends again on the machine, whether the machine manufacturer recommends it or not, whether the machine really can be operated 24 hours or not. Because if the manufacturer itself does not recommend, then why taking the risk? Because it can degrade the machine faster. And also, if maybe the machine is initially only recommended to be run 8 hours a day, and the maintenance is done maybe about every month, then if we run the machine for 24 hours, then maybe we have to do maintenance earlier than expected. So not once a month, but maybe 3 times a month. I think if you want to run the machine 24 hours, first look at the manufacturer recommendation and do it at your own risk.
Okay, thank you very much, Rosaline, for your answer and your presentation. It's a great presentation from your research, and we appreciate so much your time, your present in this seminar. Thank you very much.
Silakan, sir.
Silakan saya kembalikan ke panitia.
Baik, kita sudah di ujung acara. Mungkin ada closing remarks-nya Ibu Rosaline untuk acara event hari ini.
Mungkin waktunya masih agak panjang nih, Bu.
Oh, masih panjang.
Ya, waktunya itu kita masih cukup panjang, jadi mungkin kita ngobrol-ngobrol aja di luar. Ya,
kalau masih panjang, okay, we open for the next session of question, I think ya Pak.
Ya.
Yeah. Ya, please do raise your hand or you can write down in the chat room, either in bahasa Indonesia or in English ya. Yeah. Ya, yeah, Rosalind, sorry for that, that your time is.
Mungkin not, lebih
not get finished ya.
Lebih ke internal aja ya supaya.
So this, yeah, Pak Dena, we have also question not related to the topic anyway. Jadi ada pertanyaan yang tidak ada hubungannya dengan topik, ya, yeah, whether it will be answered by Rosalind or by you as a head of study program. Yeah. The question is, saya mahasiswa teknik mesin, ya, di bidang konversi energi. Tetapi saya juga tertarik dengan bidang proses production, produksi. Dan saya ingin mempelajari proses produksi termasuk optimasi. Saya ada sedikit pertanyaan, ya, berdasarkan latar belakang saya, kira-kira saya bisa mulai dari mana, ya, untuk bisa mempelajari seperti yang dilakukan oleh Rosalind. Thank you. Ya, mungkin Pak Dena ya, you can answer ya. The question ya.
Mungkin dimulai sama Rosalind dulu jawab, nanti saya tambahkan. Silakan Rosalind. Ya.
Belajar. Belajar di SGW ya Pak?
Iya. Gimana belajar di SGW siapa?
How to start, Rosalind?
Start.
How to? He's not, from industrial engineering ya. Yeah? He's from mechanical engineering.
Ya, pengalaman pribadi aja silakan, Rosalind.
Ibu Rosalind kan background-nya beda, itu bukan production. Dari mekatronik ke engineering management. Nah, itu preparing-nya gimana sehingga terikuti semua yang di engineering management. Itu yang ditanya beliau tadi.
Preparation-nya, ya. Yeah. Like, nowadays, I think to get information, you can get it easily from the internet. From YouTube, from even now you can access free ebooks from the internet. I think if you are just being proactive and you have the willingness to learn, I think you can do whatever you want. You can learn anything you want because it's already there. It's just you have to search it in the Google or in the YouTube or something.
Okay. Okay, very good, Rosalind. Thank you for the question, for the answer. Let me add ya. Jadi kalau saya melihat background yang penanya ini adalah mechanical engineering. Kebetulan Rosalind ini memang dalam kerjanya itu ada di bidang engineering management ya. Sehingga interest beliau pun juga udah mulai ke arah sana. Sehingga dan juga di dalam kelas juga udah dipersiapkan ya. Dari aspek-aspek kelas dari engineering management di MMI ini kita persiapkan salah satunya juga scheduling juga ada di salah satu dari kelas kita ya. Jadi memang background mechanical engineering bisa kalau memang karir memaksa, memang tujuan dari engineering management itu adalah kita itu menjembatani teman-teman ya yang dari backgroundnya teknik. Kemudian dikarenakan karir ya yang misalkan di suatu manufacturer gitu akhirnya harus menjadi seorang pemimpin lah di situ yang akhir-akhirnya harus berhubungan dengan banyak manajerial ya kerja manajerial ya. Nah, engineering management itu mempersiapkan teman-teman yang kurang background itu manajerial untuk bisa dan berkembang, mengembangkan karirnya di situ, gitu ya. Jadi memang langkah-langkahnya itu cukup mendalami beberapa aspek ya, dari manajerial, leadership juga ada di engineering management, juga termasuk finance engineering kita juga pelajari, juga banyak tentang scheduling ya yang dilakukan. Jadi engineering management itu seperti campuran antara industrial engineering juga dengan bisnis, tetapi dengan konten dari engineer sebagai lecturer-nya, sehingga lebih pas gitu untuk teman-teman yang dari background tekniknya.
Mungkin another question, Pak. Jawab. Yeah, ini another question not related to the topic also ya. Manajemen pribadi adalah hal yang paling sulit saya konsistensikan. Ya. Yeah. Terutama manajemen waktu. Sebagai mahasiswa teknik elektronika, instrumentasi teknik elektronika, saya juga mempelajari dasar-dasar manajemen mutu industri. Sumber belajar dari kampus saja rasanya masih belum cukup. Saya perlu membuka wawasan baru, menemukan sudut pandang baru terkait subjek yang disampaikan oleh Rosalind ini. Bagaimana, apa yang dapat saya lakukan ya supaya bisa menambah wawasan khususnya dalam menerapkan ilmu manajemen di dalam industri dan karir saya kelak.
Ya, pertanyaannya bagus sekali ya, itu luar biasa deh. Itu tapi saya sebetulnya ingin mendengarkan dari sudut pandang dulu mahasiswa kita yang udah berpengalaman ya, Rosalind. Coba saya ingin dengar kalau dari Rosalind seperti apa tuh jawabannya itu. Karena itu pertanyaannya cukup luas dan menarik untuk datang mungkin untuk dijawab oleh student juga. Silakan Rosalind.
Tadi bisa di-repeat questionnya.
Kenapa?
Repeat the question.
Oh, repeat ya. Saya adalah ulangi. Manajemen pribadi adalah hal yang paling sulit saya konsistensikan, yang paling sulit dilakukan ya, dikonsistensikan. Terutama manajemen waktu. Sebagai mahasiswa teknik elektronika instrumentasi, saya juga mempelajari dasar-dasar manajemen mutu industri. Sumber belajar dari kampus saja saya rasa masih belum cukup. Ya. Saya perlu membuka wawasan, menemukan sudut pandang baru terkait subjek ini dan pendekatan baru. Nah, bagaimana yang harus saya lakukan agar dapat menerapkan ilmu manajemen mutu industri dalam karir saya kelak ya, seperti yang dilakukan Rosalind. Mengerti maksudnya? Itu long question.
Iya, maksudnya dia mau menggunakan ilmu yang dia pelajari di kampus.
Bukan. Let me sort the question ya. This guy come from teknik elektronika instrumentasi. Ya, dia itu karena dari teknik ya, manajemen waktunya itu kurang bagus ya, dan dia juga belajar manajemen mutu tapi belajarnya tidak struktur lah ya, tidak struktur. Nah ini bagaimana menurut tak ini pandangan Rosalind, apa yang harus dia lakukan karena dia kan harus kerja di industri nih supaya bisa memahami seperti yang tadi disampaikan Rosalind ya, production scheduling, maintenance, anything, and so on and so forth. Yeah. So, can you give suggestion to him or her? I don't know, it's him or her. Yeah.
From my side, I think again if you cannot like commit to like this full time course in university, then you can learn by yourself. Nowadays, the internet also have these like learning courses that you can sign up for, and you can learn from it with a flexible schedule. If schedule is your issue, Yeah, I think that's one. And the second one is learn from the free sources. Like you don't have to schedule anything. If you want to read a book or watch a YouTube videos.
Yeah, Pak Hendri, okay. Pak Renal, you.
Yeah, okay. I think I add that answer. Mungkin saya sih pengen tahu aja juga bagaimana cara berpikirnya. Tapi untuk menjawab pertanyaan ini ya, background-nya beliau itu adalah elektro, kemudian tertarik dalam melakukan suatu quality control. Ya jawabannya itu yang tadi yang Rosalie sebutkan, tetapi sebetulnya yang pasnya adalah sekolah lagi, teruskan sekolah, karena kalau di sekolah itu akan dididik dengan kelengkapannya, ya. Dari aspek kelengkapan secara terstruktur ini pasnya di mekanika engineering kita, master mekanika engineering, kalau tertarik untuk ke managerial, yaitu bergabung di engineering management, di dalamnya adalah semua yang menyangkut dengan managerial skill yang diperlukan untuk di industri, ya. Jadi ya, memang mudah-mudahan bisa berkomitmen ya, karena kalau tentang disiplin diri segala macam itu biasanya dengan struktur sekolahan itu akan dibantu, ya. Tetapi memang harus ada komitmen waktu dan komitmen finansial dan komitmen ya cukup kerja keras lah itu dan tenaga itu. Jadi memang kayaknya tidak bisa ya. Memang juga sebetulnya yang kunci pengembangan diri itu adalah membaca itu. Cuman kalau dari universitas membaca itu adalah yang selalu kita dorong ya untuk mengembangkan wawasan orang itu pengetahuan adalah membaca dan melakukan suatu exercise dari analisa dan segala macam. Ya mungkin itu jawaban dari saya. Mungkin Pak Henry ada mau tambahan, Pak Henry silakan.
Ini ada pertanyaan khusus buat Pak Henry nih.
Yo.
Ya, ini Pak Hendri nanti yang ini khusus Pak Hendri ini sama Rosa dan Pak Hendri ini, especially for you both ya, because it's designed for you both. Especially it's designed for you both ya. It is hard for me to understand how much IoT, machine learning, and artificial intelligence needed in automation industry, considering limited resources as our challenge. And how is your suggestion? Rosalie and Pak Henry. Go ahead. Siapa yang mau jawab? Bukan saya nggak bisa jawab ini ya. Of course I cannot answer this question. Rosalie, can you understand the question? It is hard for me to understand how much IoT, machine learning, and AI needed in automation industry, considering limited resources as our challenge.
Oh gitu.
Gimana? Saya mau refresh pertanyaannya bagaimana ya? You can refresh the question of course.
Jadi dia ingin belajar IoT, kemudian salah satunya itu adalah machine learning, kemudian artificial intelligence, tetapi sumber-sumber yang tersedia itu katanya terbatas. Sebenarnya enggak terbatas, Pak. Sangat banyak. Ya, sangat banyak sekali, baik itu machine learning, baik itu artificial intelligence, software-softwarenya juga sudah ada yang gratis. Kemudian mungkin yang terpikir oleh beliau ini ketika nanti dihubungkan dengan automasi sistem itu selalu berpikir bahwa alat-alatnya mahal. Itu dulu. Kalau sekarang dengan adanya Arduino, Android, kemudian banyak lagi yang murah-murah yang harganya juga di bawah 50.000 kita bisa dapatkan bisa ngembangkan IoT, bisa ngembangkan machine learning, terserah lah nanti di situ ada artificial intelligence. Ya, bisa sangat-sangat, kalau saat ini sudah sangat-sangat bisa dan tidak terlalu rumit, Pak. Contoh-contohnya juga sudah diserahkan, sudah tersedia di Google, di GitHub, ya, GitHub-nya apa istilahnya, ada forum yang memberikan fasilitas secara gratis. Nah, jadi bagi Bapak yang bertanya, jangan terlalu khawatir, untuk belajar IoT itu cukup sebentar waktunya, tidak lama. Untuk belajar machine learning juga, seperti beberapa mahasiswa kita yang sedang mengembangkan face recognize dengan machine learning, itu juga sudah ada software-software gratis yang membantu sebagai awal untuk belajar. Selain dari kita sendiri, belajar pemrograman. Jadi kalau kita ingin membuat platform sendiri, berarti kita harus membuat programnya sendiri. Tapi kalau kita mau menggunakan fasilitas yang free dengan keterbatasan fasilitas yang dia berikan, itu konsep-konsep IoT sudah bisa kita jalankan untuk automasi industri. Okay. Ya, tapi ya, gitu Pak.
Pak Henry, ini langsung dijawab saja dari di chatroom oleh dari Pak Henry nih. Ini kan sama nih. Related. Bagaimana cara mempersiapkan lulusan agar siap kerja di dunia industri? Mayoritas saat ini masih terlalu jauh gap lulusan ketika terjun ke dunia industri. Fokusnya di engineering. Nah, di dunia otomasi industri yang kebanyakan menggunakan PLC sebagai kontrol, sebagai otomasinya. Ini dari Pak Andri Widiarto.
Ya, tadi seperti yang disampaikan Pak Dena sebagai Head of Mechanical Engineering. Jadi Pak Andri, kita juga harus punya waktu spesial ya untuk belajar. Yang PLC ini juga sudah tersedia, walaupun kita tidak memiliki memiliki peralatan yang seperti yang branded ya, yang mahal-mahal, Mitsubishi, Schneider, apalagi yang murah-murah juga ada, kita bisa kembangkan. Nah, yang software-software gratis juga sudah disiapkan, sehingga dari software-software gratis itu kita bisa belajar sendiri. Selain dari memang kita harus mengupgrade diri kita untuk sekolah lagi atau mengambil kursus di bidang itu. Jadi untuk industri 4.0 ini, kita mau tidak mau sebagai engineer, baik itu mechanical, electrical, ya, industrial engineering, kemudian IT, itu harus memang mendekati ke arah automasi artificial intelligence. Nah, PLC salah satu perangkat yang digunakan. Nah, intinya tadi seperti yang disebutkan pembicara, ya harus belajar lagi. Jadi harus ada waktu lagi. Memang kita secara tidak mau kita secara tidak bisa meninggalkan untuk tetap mengupgrade diri. Jadi kalau kita tidak belajar lagi, Pak, kita akan tertinggal. Nah, seperti pribadi saya, itu ketika saya belajar otomasi industri, zaman itu saya belum, mata kuliahnya tidak ada. Nah, tapi tugas harus selesai. Bagaimana? Ya, belajar lagi, buat sendiri, belajar lagi. Ya, intinya begitu. Kalau enggak, kita memang tertinggal. Jadi kalau industri 4.0, ya larinya ke otomasi, kemudian mekatronik. Ya, salah satu PLC ya, PLC bisa juga dikembangkan dari sana. Mungkin gitu Pak Gembong.
Mungkin saya tanya ya ke Rosalin nih. Rosalin, apa manfaat dari proyek tesis ini untuk pekerjaan di Rosalin di kantor? Apakah ini dirasakan bermanfaat atau bagaimana efeknya untuk ke perusahaan dengan proyek ini?
Okay, sir. So first of all, the company that I use for my thesis subject is not the company that I'm working on right now. So I cannot compare. I cannot make comparison to the company that I'm working with. But for this company, for the subject company of my thesis, it will be beneficial for them because now they have this scheduling issue, and they don't have any tools to support them, and they don't know where to start. But if I can provide this free software from my thesis project to them, then they can use it, and they can use it as a guideline to make the production scheduling in their company.
Okay.
So and that's definitely beneficial for them.
Okay, very good. And are they planning to use your scheduling? Did you prove that it's already working the way you plan?
Yes, sir. So as of now, the scheduling has worked. As you can see, it can produce the output in the form of Gantt chart, which is so easy to understand. And if they want a detailed result, or it can also produce the data in Excel form, in Excel format. And yeah, they already see it and they said, yeah, that is very good. And it will definitely help them to make decision later on.
Okay, very good. This software and the methodology that you are using, is it applicable to any other company that has maybe similar problem? Or what do you think? How flexible is your program for any other company?
I would say it can be implemented to the company that is also in job shop type. But in pro shop, I don't know, it needs further research, I think. But in job shop, it can definitely be implemented because there is no machine restriction, like the maximum number of machine, no maximum number of tasks, no maximum number of jobs. So you can use it.
Oh, very good. So it looks like this this project can be extendable, yeah, to any company, and any other company will get the benefit of what you are doing, actually. So yeah, this is good. Very good. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Silakan Pak Gembong lagi. Mungkin saya tambahkan tadi ya, dari yang Pak Hen tadi tentang yang ingin mengetahui tentang mekatronik ya. Jadi ya seperti yang tadi Pak Hendy sebutkan ya, bahwa mekatronik, Master of Mechanic Engineering itu mempunyai fokus di mekatronik dan engine management ya. Untuk teman-teman yang tertarik mekatronik, silakan untuk bergabung, karena kita akan memperkuat dan memperkenalkan dari sangat basic ya, yaitu dari basic mechanical engineering-nya, electrical engineering-nya, dan programming-nya ya. Jadi ya mungkin para hadirin tahu ya bahwa mekatronik itu berdasarkan dari tiga subjek tersebut ya. Jadi silakan untuk bergabung dan kita akan melakukan pembelajarannya step by step ya. Jadi itu adalah pilihan yang kalau untuk dan di dalamnya kita akan belajar tentang IoT, automation, dan segala macamnya. Jadi biasanya yang kita lakukan aplikasinya di exercise dalam bentuk project thesis, di mana aplikasi dari mekatronik di engineering di suatu manufacturer atau gimana bisa dicobakan dan diimplementasikan. Jadi project thesis itu menjadi suatu exercise lah, sehingga para student bisa melihat bagaimana manfaatnya dari keilmuan mekatronik dalam suatu proses industri gitu ya, begitu. Dan juga Rosa juga merasakan ya, you already feel it ya, that what you learn is related to what you see in the industry ya, is that right, Rosa? Ya. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Silakan Pak Gembong or Pak Henry.
Okay, yeah. Anyway, how much time we have?
We have 15 more minutes.
15 more minutes. Here we have a question, yeah, from Muhammad. Siapa ini ya? You can read in the chat room. A question regarding the thesis of Rosalind. So you have already the result of your thesis. Do you have, the question is, do you have any baseline to be compared with? Yeah, because there are a lot of methods that are already exist. The question are always, why this method? Is this better than this or this? What are the advantages of this method compared with others? So you can answer either Bahasa Indonesia or English. Yeah.
So for verification, you mean for verification, I'm still gathering the data from the company historical data. But the reason why I choose this method is I can show you the comparison table. Here, this is the advantage and disadvantage of genetic algorithm. So you can see here the genetic algorithm has a good global search ability, but it is lack of local search ability. And then if you see here, the second method that I choose is a taboo search. You see here that the advantage is it has good local search ability, but the disadvantage is it lack of global search ability. So here we can see that both of methods are complementing each other. That's why I choose this method. And to support, this is, we can see here in the GA plus PS, we can see the advantage of combining GA and PS, genetic algorithm and taboo search is to search, so it can have a good search in local and global, and the design and cost is not complicated. Actually, we can also combine the here. He said that genetic algorithm and PNS, but the disadvantage is complicated algorithm. So that's why I choose a genetic algorithm and taboo search. It is not as complicated, but it serves its purpose. That's why.
Okay, thank you very much. I don't know whether you the Pak siapa tadi, you can catch the answer from Rosalind. Yeah? Hopefully, Pak Muhammad.
Yeah, it's fine, Pak. Sudah, saya sudah ngerti.
Oh, Pak Rizky. Okay.
Makasih.
You welcome, Pak. From Albert. Yeah, very interesting listening to the discussion among my lecturer at MME. I'm sorry I cannot open my mic because still working hour. Thanks for the insight that has been shared, Pak Gemong. Okay, this is not question, yeah. Sorry. Okay, finally, I think there's no more question to you, Rosalind. Yeah.
Let me ask question, Pak.
Oh yeah, but then I have a question.
Okay, Rosalind, a question for you. Yeah. Can you tell me which course in the Master of Mechanical Engineering that you took that give you the most influence benefit to your career? And can you explain more? Yeah.
I mean, sir, it's hard to choose one because first of all of the subjects that I took in the engineering management, I'm not familiar with. And maybe for the first semester only, but the other subjects, it is brand new to me. So I cannot choose one because I learned so much from all of the subjects. So I think all.
You think all, yeah. Can you say at least three most, so, and then explain what they are and what give you the influence to your career effect?
Strategic management.
Okay.
And then this one, sir, about scheduling, but I forgot the course name. And also about marketing.
Marketing, sales and marketing.
Okay. Yes.
Can you explain what's the effect to you that about the strategic management that you said? What is things that you really enjoy and learn and give you influence?
For strategic management, it's that because I never learned about the strategic management, and so what Pak Gembong has taught me has really opened my eyes, and I need to think out of the box, and that's really really interesting for me. That's a new thing for me. That's for strategic management, and then for this scheduling, it's I think the subject also needed in if you are working in the industry manufacturing sector, because if you can make an optimized schedule, then you can present it to your boss, and with effective schedule, you can help the company to save costs and get more profit. The boss will like you, of course. And then for marketing, I think also it is just to, I think if you, because now I'm working in the automation department, I think it will be beneficial for me if I also know the marketing and sales strategy, because sometimes I also like meet with the customer. I think if I know like some marketing terms, some sales terms, and how to do the selling, it can be beneficial for me in my career.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, that's interesting, Rosaline. I have to make a point here that Rosaline's background is in engineering, in mechatronic engineering, a technical aspect. So this is similar to the people who ask, yeah, that from the electronic and also from the mechanical engineering. So those people that are in the technical side can learn about the managerial, similar to what Rosaline did. There are a lot of things that we learn on managerial side. But if you would like to keep getting the information and more into the technical mechatronic, that is also available in mechanical engineering. Okay, thank you, Rosaline. I give it back to Pak Gembong.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you, Pak Dena, Rosaline, and Pak Andri. I think cover all the issue, yeah, whether technical education and also the strategic view of the talk itself. So now I give it back the time to MC, please.
Baik, terima kasih Bapak Gembong. Kita sudah di ujung acara. Terima kasih kepada Ibu Rosaline untuk pemaparan dan ulasannya. Serta terima kasih kepada Bapak Gembong yang sudah mendampingi sebagai moderator. Sebelum kita masuk sesi foto bersama, izinkan saya bertanya kepada salah satu atau beberapa Bapak yang hadir untuk memberi tanggapan dan testimoni singkat mengenai series Engineers Talk hari ini. Kepada Bapak Fahtoni, Ahmad Fahtoni, dipersilakan, boleh memberikan testimoni.
Selamat sore, terima kasih.
Sore.
Pada Pak Dena, Pak Gembong, Henry, dan Bu Rosaline. Ini pertama sih pengalaman saya ikut acara Engineering Talk ya. Menurut saya sih oke ya, sangat bagus. Jadi kita juga jujur aja sih, hal kayak gini sih baru buat saya. Saya di industri FMCG, selama ini juga untuk optimizing production itu masih konvensional. Menurut saya sih ini sangat berguna juga gitu loh. Karena SKU atau varian produk di situ hampir 500 varian. Jadi mungkin dengan kayak gini tuh mungkin akan lebih berguna banget gitu. Cuma nanti mungkin tantangan biasanya sih dari dunia akademi ke dunia industri, biasanya secara match link yang paling nanti sih yang mungkin perlu disesuaikan. Itu aja sih mungkin perlu tantangannya. Mungkin dari acara ini sendiri, menurut saya sih mungkin bisa dibuat lebih interaktif kali ya. Jadi mungkin nggak cuma satu dua orang yang nanya, mungkin bisa lebih interaktif aja sih. Itu aja sih mungkin untuk saran kedepannya. Itu aja sih mungkin. Terima kasih Pak Adena, Pak Gembong masuk.
Baik, terima kasih kepada Bapak Ahmad Fahtoni. Kemudian saya untuk memberikan testimoni, satu lagi kepada Bapak Muhammad Rizky di Prastia, waktu dan tempat saya persilahkan.
Oh, testimoni ya, ya. Di saya itu sebenarnya itu alumni SGU tahun 2011. Itu masuk berarti lulus tuh tahun 2015 ya. Habis itu saya lanjut master di Jerman, kemudian sekarang lagi PhD. Kebetulan aja saya tadi ngelihat ada engineering talks about production scheduling. Karena di departemen saya juga rata-rata research di bidang terutama di automation engineer juga sama di machine learning. Terus menurut saya engineering talk kali ini ya quite interesting, terutama dengan job scheduling ini, dengan metode yang diimplementasi oleh Ibu Rosalyn, di mana metode ini cukup menurut saya cukup bagus dengan alasan Ibu Rosalyn kenapa mengambil genetic algorithm dan hybrid taboo search. I think ini juga tidak terlalu kompleks dan ini juga mudah untuk diimplementasi di dalam manufacturing itself. Jadi nggak kayak seperti machine learning yang which is more complex than this, seperti komputasi dan lain-lainnya. Ini bisa simple diimplementasi dalam manufacturing. Terus kemudian ya mungkin kedepannya saya berharap juga untuk engineering talks lain kalinya mungkin saya bisa hadir juga, terutama apabila itu di bidang seperti machine learning, IoT, automation, and then yeah, something like that. Terus ya di sini juga kebanyakan pada nanya ya gimana sih transfer dari akademik ke industri, karena itu kadang akademik itu terlalu eksperimental, I would say. Jadi ada beberapa research yang hanya di paper saja atau let's say di simulasi saja, bagus numbernya di paper tapi sangat sulit untuk ditransfer ke industri itself. Yeah. Mungkin itu saja dari saya. So far, yeah, it's good. Thank you.
Baik, terima kasih kepada Bapak Muhammad Rizky. Sesi selanjutnya kita akan foto bersama. Dimohon Bapak Ibu untuk mengaktifkan fitur kameranya. Mohon dibantu untuk Bapak Wisnu atau tim kami yang sedang mengikuti acara hari ini.
Wah, ramai nih Pak Hasanuddin.
Ada Pak Hasan.
Ya, Pak Hasan lagi rame-rame itu.
Di kantor, Pak, rame.
Nggak apa-apa, diaktifin aja Pak, biar rame fotonya.
Baik, terima kasih. Saya perlu ingatkan kembali, di kolom chat telah tersedia form feedback survey yang Bapak Ibu dapat isi. Silakan diisi karena dalam form tersebut terdapat e-sertifikat yang Bapak Ibu bisa peroleh, dan tentu saja kami memerlukan feedback agar menjadi improvement kami untuk selanjutnya menghadirkan series Engineers Talk yang kian berkualitas. Demikian selesai acara Engineers Talk hari ini. Kami ucapkan terima kasih untuk partisipasi dan kehadiran Bapak-Ibu dalam acara ini. Semoga bermanfaat. Untuk sekedar informasi, kami SGU sedang membuka pendaftaran program S2 Mechanical Engineering dengan konsentrasi Engineering Management dan Mechatronics untuk intake bulan Februari 2022. Untuk informasi lebih lanjut, silakan hubungi hotline kami dan jangan lupa follow sosial media kami untuk update acara selanjutnya. Terlampir dalam kolom chat. Sekian kami pamit undur diri. Terima kasih Bapak Ibu, stay safe dan stay healthy.
Terima kasih semua.
Terima kasih. Terima kasih Bu Rosa.
Pak Yanokta, Pak Hasan dan lain-lain ya.
Pak Yanokta, selamat bergabung.
Terima kasih Rosa.
Baru kelihatan nih. Ternyata ada yang saya kenal di sini.
Siapa?
Itu Pak, ada itu mahasiswa alumni saya juga. Yanokta Dwianto. Di mana Pak posisinya nih?
Di Pekanbaru, Pak.
Pekanbaru ya. Oke, salam. Salam sama alumni ya. Pak Muhammad Rizky, kita sebelum-sebelumnya sudah banyak Pak yang talk webinar machine learning Pak, artificial intelligence Pak.